And I want to delve into all of the themes in your book, but let me dovetail on something you just mentioned, because there's a question from the audience regarding the super committee, which is apparently on the verge of announcing a failure today to solve some of the debt issues and trying to reduce the deficit, something like $1.2 trillion over 10 years. And you refer to gridlock. This is the kind of frustration that I think many Americans feel, that this group in Washington charged with this task was able to come up with nothing.
About 3 years ago in Montana, one of my neighbors, a really smart guy, very conservative, came to me one day and he said, I'm just terrified about this national debt. And I said, well, the one encouraging thing is it's now on the agenda. And when we get things on the agenda, we find a way to work them out. I was wrong. I really didn't believe that we could become as polarized as we have been. That this committee, given what we know that we have to do in some fashion, was unable to find a way to even start the process. And based on all the reporting that I've been able to do and others have been able to do, they haven't even been talking to each other very much in the last 6 weeks. That's just unacceptable, it seems to me. Now, one of the examples that I use wherever I go, I actually use two. I was asked to come to the White House about 2 years ago. This is not unusual in every administration. I've done this as a reporter because I go across the country and I kind of have a feel for what's going on. I don't advise presidents, but I'm willing to report to them on what I see. I told this president the country was divided into two parts. One half is half-cocked in the ticked-off position, although I used another phrase besides ticked-off. And they are in a rage, and they don't believe in anything anymore. And that was before the Tea Party got started, but it was the roots of the Tea Party. So the other half of the country has given up on you, not just on you, but on Congress as well. A lot of them voted for you. And on Main Street America, they're just worrying about taking care of Main Street. The Republican bankers working with the Democrat who is a backhoe operator, the car dealer who maybe the Republican is working with, the Mexican-American worker at the food plant on the edge of town trying to make sure that they can buy a car. They're trying to hold what they've got together. And they've given up on our institutions of governance. I've never seen such a separation between Washington and the rest of the country. Congress is now in single digits in terms of people having confidence in it. That's an astonishing number. The other piece of it that I use is that we've asked less than 1% of our population to fight the two longest wars in our history. They're taking 100% of the bullets for the other 99% of us. What do we say to them about how we're behaving at home? They're mission-oriented. They come from all over America. They find a way to fight together and to solve problems and to win hearts and minds. They do that all day, every day, and they've been doing it for 10 years, often in multiple tours. Now they're coming home, we hope, but to what turns out to be a broken economy and a broken political system. It's a terrible commentary on everyone. And then I end up, not in the White House, but in gatherings like this, saying, I think it's time for the rest of us to re-enlist the citizens. We're going to have to step forward here because they're not getting the job done. We're going to have to find a way to put pressure on them to get the job done.